Good morning, GCFNE. Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. So tumayo po muna tayong lahat at sabihan natin ang ating mga katabi na rejoice, brother. Rejoice, sister. Amen. So before we start singing today, let us read in Psalms chapter 145, verses 8 to 10. In verse 8, it says, "The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and His mercy is over all that He has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you." So today, let us be reminded of God's grace, His steadfast love for us. Though undeserving as we are, He sacrificed His only Son to take our place. He endured the cross, despised the shame, and He did it all with joy. So as we sing this song, let us be reminded of how deep the Father's love is towards us. This I know with all my heart,
So Faithful.
have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you were close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Surrender now, I give you everything. So your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Let's sing it again, your goodness. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. It's your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
Let us remain in this worshipful attitude as we dedicate this time as a part of our worship through our prayers. Join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We lift your name on high, O Lord. We offer our highest praise and thanksgiving. And yes, Lord, you are truly faithful, and we will sing of your goodness indeed, O Lord. Our Master, our Provider, our Healer, our Banner, our Righteousness, our Peace, our Shepherd, our Sanctifier, a God that never changed, our Sovereign God. You are worthy of all these titles, Lord, and deserve all the praises and honor we offer today. We praise your name, Heavenly Father. Lord, we humble ourselves and confess to you our shortcomings. We cannot come before your throne, Lord, if we have this sin in our hearts. We have failed you so many times in our daily walk. We wander from the path of righteousness, and we confess this in your presence, O Lord. We ask and repent of this, Father. Please do not deal with us as our sins deserve, but wash us clean in the blood of Jesus Christ and empower us by your Spirit to live to honor and serve only you, our Savior King. We come to Christ who has promised rest for our souls. We take his yoke upon us. We desire to learn from him. Grant us, Lord, that we may bring forth the fruits of repentance from sincere hearts, Lord, which are precious in your sight. We lift to you, Heavenly Father, for our brethren who are now sick. Would you grant them, Lord, your healing touch in whatever current situation they are facing right now? For you are the Jehovah Rapha, the one who heals and restores. Please do extend as well your blessings to meet their needs, Lord God. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We entrust to you this time our nation's leaders and our country. We pray, Lord God, for the moral uprightness of our leaders and our government. It is our prayer and desire that salvation befall upon all of this public servant, that the gospel of the Lord will advance in the government so that righteousness will upheld and be the norm in the public service. Please intervene that they may stay away from corrupt practices and remain firm on good governance to pave the way for our country's progress. We pray, Lord God, that for those affected by the unrest of Mayan volcano, please, Lord God, grant them protection, provision, and comfort to the families affected by this. Please give wisdom as well to the LGU on how they will manage and support the affected families of this calamity. We pray, Lord God, that you will diminish the unrest of Mayon to prevent any potential and devastating effect in the whole province of Bicol and Albay. Thank you, Lord. We entrust to you right now all the volunteers of your church, GCF Northeast. We praise and thank you, Lord, for the recent leaders' retreat, which provided nourishment, both spiritual and physical. Lord, continue to bless the plans we have discussed, that this may be aligned on your will in the advancement of your kingdom. May we ask, Lord God, to guide us and all volunteers that we will be consistent in our walk with you through the study of your word, that the service offered to you and desire to know you more will be only used in the advancement of your kingdom. We pray for Pastor Boyet. Lord, we thank you for our pastor's life, being the shepherd you have entrusted in GCF Northeast. Please help him to grow in his faith each day and continue to be a man who is above reproach. Let him embrace continually Christ-like humility in his everyday walk. Continue to grant him a teachable spirit who is sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit in his life. Help him to make good, sound decisions for the congregation you have entrusted him with. Please continue to sustain his good health, both physical and spiritual. Shield him from any attacks of the enemies. Help him not to grow weary in well-doing, but provide him of your grace upon grace. Would you please anoint Pastor Boyd as well with your spirit, as you will use him for your glory in preaching of your word today in Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 to 7. May every word will be proclaimed with power and clarity. And with the same spirit, Lord, we ask that you give us the faith to receive your word. Open the eyes of our understanding to reveal your truth and lead us to obedience for the glory of your name. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer. For all of this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. It's a joy and a blessing to see you all. Thank you for those who are watching online. Thank you for joining us. And you are really an answer to our prayers. And we continue our study on the book of Exodus. No, meron pong mga bagay na inaakala natin ay napakahalaga. No, pero hindi naman pala, they prove to be otherwise. But there are some things that we think they are undesirable, even painful, but they prove to be beneficial or profitable or precious. Diba? Kala ko hindi ko nakakayanin yung dinaanan ko. Diba? May narinig na kayo yun. Pero kahit gaano kahirap yon, hindi ko makakalimutan yung karanasan na yon. And it helped me a lot. And our text is an excellent example of that. The Israelites viewed their lack of water at Rephidim as a disaster and the absence of God as an indication that he had left them to die in the wilderness. And they questioned whether God was with them or not. And in reality, God was with them in a way that was beyond comprehension, a way that would be revealed centuries later by the Apostle Paul. At what first appeared to be an indication of God's absence proved to be one of the most dramatic illustrations of the presence, the power, the provision, and the protection of God. And let us listen carefully to the words of this text, for they offer encouragement to every saint who has ever questioned the presence of God in a time of personal crisis. So may I request everyone to please rise as we read our passage in Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 to 7. Exodus 17, verses 1 to 7. Those watching online, please follow along as we read the text. Let us read all together. Then all the congregation of the sons of Israel journeyed by stages from the wilderness of Sin, according to the command of the Lord, and camped at Rephidim, and there was no water for the people to drink. So the people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water so that we may drink." And Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people were thirsty for water there, and they grumbled against Moses and said, "Why is it that you have brought us up from Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, "What am I to do with these people? A little more and they will stone me." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Pass before the people and take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand your staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it so that the people may drink." And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Then he named the place Massah and Meribah because of the quarrel of the sons of Israel, and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This is God's holy, inspired, and inerrant word. You may all be seated. All people are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Lord, this is your word. Would you instruct us in faith and in grace and to keep us from temptations? Make our hearts good soil for your word. Teach, correct, rebuke, and encourage us. Show us our sin and show us more of Christ. In his name we pray. Amen and amen. We've said several times that God is, among other things, teaching the children of Israel to live by the grace of God in the wilderness. Living by grace in this instance entails trusting God to provide. Magtiwala sa Diyos na siya ay sapat. Magtiwala sa karunungan ng Diyos kung saan sila ililid at kung paano sila ililid ng Diyos, and being obedient in the instruction and commands of God. God is the one who has taken them this way. Naalala nyo, sa simula pag-aral natin, paglabas sa Egypt, no? 2 linggo lang papunta dun sa Canaan, pero dinirek sila ng God doon sa opposite way. Pero nung napunta sila sa Mara, nakita po natin, di po ba mapait yung tubig, at ito'y pinatamis ng Diyos, naging drinkable, and then nandoon po sila sa Masa Meriba. No, ito ngayon yung ending ng pag-aaral natin doon, ay nagbuhos, nagpaulan ang Diyos ng mana. Pero pinapakita ng bayang Israel, ang mga Israelita, they don't want to live by the grace of God. No? But we must remember the big picture. Ano po ba ang layunin ng Diyos? God is preparing these people to what? Diba? Ano ang layunin ng Diyos para nung simula, nung sinabi ni Moses, bigyan nyo kami ng long weekend, pupunta kami sa wilderness to worship Him, to serve Him. That is the great point of Exodus, to create a people who will worship Him. And by creating a people who will worship Him, hindi lamang gusto ng Diyos yung liturgical, ritual actions, external, na sila'y nagtataas ng kamay, pumapalakpak, tumatalon, di po ba, nagsasayaw. But there must be comprehensive trust in Him, being obedient to Him, loving Him. No, God desires a people who will worship Him in all of life, from the depths of their heart, in faith, and being obedient before, during, after corporate praise. Yun ang naisin, ninanais ng Diyos, that they will worship Him in all of life. Ibig sabihin, kahit yan ay merong paghihirap, andoon na matitinding pagsubok, even in situations where they will trust Him, they will obey Him, yun ang ninanais ng Diyos sa kanila. And today, ay meron pong tatlong principles or tatlong section na makita natin sa ating passage. Ang una is in verses 1 to 3. At makikita natin muli ang reaksyon nitong mga Israelita. Verse 1 says, "Then all the congregation of the sons of Israel journeyed by stages from the wilderness of Sin, according to the command of the Lord, encamped at Rephidim, and there was no water for the people to drink." So dumating po sila, they finally arrive at Rephidim, which some scholars refer to as a wadi or an oasis. So naglakad-lakad sila, remember, from the wilderness of Sin, naglakad-lakad sila ilang yon, at naubos na naman yung kanilang tubig. Okay? Naalala nyo po, nung sila ay dumating doon sa Mara, it's also a wadi or it's an oasis, pero ang tubig doon ay hindi mainom dahil sobrang pait. Now, ngayon, yung dinatnan nila, walang tubig. Imagine an oasis na walang tubig. So, nagdagdag ito ng tension at desperasyon dun sa mga tao. And of course, kung tayo po yun, siguro kung tayo nakaranas ng yung plagues, nakaranas tayo ng pagbiyak ng Red Sea at pagkatapos yung Mara, di po ba? Siguro in-expect natin yung mga Israelites should have gathered for prayer and waited for the Lord to provide for them. They should know by now that God would take care of them. Tama? Diba? Sila'y nauhaw. Wala ni sa, sabihin natin, ang adult, 600,000 men. Plus yung mga asawa nila. Sabihin natin, may 1 million. Wala ni isa sa kanila nagsabi, "Hey, let's gather. Mag-prayer meet. Corporate prayer tayo." Diba? Wala dun. Or may nagsabi sana sa kanila, hindi nyo pa ba kilala ang Diyos? Ano na ang ginawa niya sa atin? Tas eto na naman tayo. Hindi ba? Nung na tayo nasa Mara, masyadong mapait, yung tubig, subalit nagbato lang ng stick si Moses at parang the state-of-the-art distillation process. Lasang Wilkins, yung tubig. Enjoy na enjoy sila. Di po ba? And then they were hungry. Paglipat nila ilang araw, nagutom sila. At ano? Pinaulan ng Diyos ng mana, Krispy Kreme donut, bumagsak doon. At yun ang magiging for 40 years. Di po ba? Kung kayo po yun, wow, nauuhaw ka, nauuhaw ka, nauuhaw tayong lahat. Ano kaya ang gagawin ng Diyos? Babagsak ang diet ko? Iced tea? Fresh milk? Di po ba? Kung, di ba? Naisip na, ano niyo po, ini-expand ko lang yung imagination ng bawat isa. What is He going to do to quench our thirst? The circumstances, brethren, alam po natin, is really are very hard. And the reaction, maaari siguro maintindihan, walang ang tubig eh. Nung Samara may tubig. Ito, walang tubig. Mga kapatid, this is a kind of trial na sinasabi nila the standing issue for the life of faith. A standing issue for the life of faith. Maaring ilan sa atin o maaring nakaranas na nito or some or all of us, I'm sure makakaranas ng ganito. Not literally wanting water, no? Na tayo ay walang maiinom, no? Pero minsan hindi po ba kayo nagtataka, bakit ganito? Ba't ito nangyayari sa akin? I cannot understand this, Lord. Diba? Na sinasabi mo na ikay mabuti, ikay mapagmahal, that you care for me, that you value me, that I am the apple of your eye. Bakit ganito ang nangyayari sa akin? Hindi po ba? No? Makikita natin, this is what they call a standing issue of the spiritual life. And I want you to see two important points dun sa verse 1. No? Ang una, the congregation of Israel journeyed by stages from the wilderness of sin, no, according to the command of the Lord. And therefore, Israel is where she is because the Lord wants her where she is. And therefore, you also can conclude that once again, God has directed them to a place where there is no water. Ang Diyos mismo ang siyang nagdala sa kanila doon sa lugar na yon kung may oasis nga pero walang tubig. And that leads me to that second important point. Ang Rephidim is an oasis na walang tubig. You know, yun yung huling station nila eh para makapunta sila sa Horeb papunta ng Sinai. Okay? So, oasis na walang tubig. Moses doesn't tell us bakit, no? Maraming nagsasabi because the next section, yung laban nila with the Amalekites, ay baka yung mga Amalekites may ginawa para hindi makapunta yung tubig doon. So whatever the case is, the children of Israel don't have water to drink. And of course, ano ang resulta? Di ba predictable? Anong ginawa la? Verses 2 and 3. So the people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water so that we may drink." And Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people were thirsty for water there and they grumbled against Moses and said, "Why is it that you brought us up from Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" Verses 2 and 3. Anong ginawa nila? Grumble, complain, and quarrel. Now, the word quarrel has has overtones of physical confrontation. Hindi lamang sinasabi nila, "Moses, bigyan mo kami ng tubig." No. Okay? Riot. Kumbaga parang riot yung dating. No? Kaya sabi ni Moses, di ba, "Lord, anong gagawin ko? They are trying to stone me. Papatayin nila ako." No, hindi lamang yung mga tao na nagagalit na bigyan mo kami ng tubig, hindi, kumuha na sila ng bato at ipupukol nila, ibabato nila kay Moses. Okay? Tapos sinasabi nila, "Dinala mo na naman kami dito para patayin kami, patayin ang mga anak namin, patayin yung mga hayop namin, nauuhaw kami." And so the situation is so explosive na magkakaroon ng revolusyon. Nakita niyo po yung situation, walang tubig, hindi nagtitiwala yung Israel. That is the standing issue of spiritual life, the life of faith. Will you continue to trust God when there is no bread and water? Kinanta natin, to only a God like you do I give my praise. And you will give everything para sa Kanya, right? Pero ang atin po bang allegiance sa Kanya is conditional? My allegiance, my devotion, is it conditional? Lord, aawit lang ako sa iyo ng papuri kapag when things are like when I like it. When things are like when I want it. Magpupuri ako sa iyo, Diyos, kapag sinasagot mo ang aking dalangin. Kapag tinanggal mo ang aking sakit. Kapag maayos ang relasyon ko sa aking pamilya. Maayos ang aking mga anak. Magpupuri ako sa iyo. Conditional yung allegiance mo sa Panginoon. Lord, maniniwala ako na ikay mabuti, na ikay sovereign, na ikay matalino, hindi ka nagkakamali. Kung as long as things are going like I want them to go. Conditional allegiance. Now, bakit dinala ng Diyos ang mga Israelita doon sa isang lugar, sa isang oasis, walang tubig? The answer? For the same reason He brings each one of us to places of need. So that we will call upon the name of the Lord in our weakness, in our suffering. And He will be glorified when He delivers us. The Lord says in Psalm 50, verse 15, call upon me in the day of trouble, I shall rescue you, and you will honor me. So if you are in a place of trouble, before you do anything else, call upon Him. And if you've been grumbling, confess and ask for forgiveness to the Lord and ask Him to be glorified through your trial. Lord, hindi ko kaya to. Patawarin mo ako kung ako'y nagdadabog. Baguhin mo ang puso ko. Nawa, ikaw ay maluwalhati. Na ikaw, ang pangalan mo ay maitaas sa aking mga pagsubok na dinadaanan. And in verses 4 to 6, we see naman the response of God. Dito, anong response niya? Biyaya. Di po ba si Moses nagpray at nakita natin the patient and also merciful response of God. Verse 4 says, so Moses cried out to the Lord saying, what am I to do with these people? A little more and they will stone me. Di po ba? And here pinakita, no, minodel ni Moses what Israel could have done. No, napansin nyo, nobody called a prayer meeting. Diretso sila kay Moses nagre-reklamo. But Moses calls a personal prayer meeting. Ano pong na-recognize niya? Anong na-realize niya? That he is inadequate to provide water in the desert for 2 million people plus their livestock. Di po ba? And when he prayed, kanya pong sinabi sa Diyos kung gaano kalala ang sitwasyon. They are going to stone me. They are going to kill me. And this is not an overstatement. Hindi po to exage. Di po ba? Maari siguro kung ang isang manggagawa biglang may dumating sa akin at sabihin niya, Pastor, yung church ko gusto nila akong batuhin. Di po ba? Siguro metaphorical yun. Paaring isipin ko, gusto siyang patalsikin. Pero when you talk of Moses here, of Paul, of Stephen, of the Lord Jesus Christ, hindi metaphorical yun, literal yun. Di po ba? And when Moses' life was on the line, what did he do? He prayed. Nakataya na ang buhay niya, babatuhin siya. His response, trust. His response, resort to God. And what does God do in verse 5? Then the Lord said to Moses, pass before the people and take with you some of the elders of Israel and take in your hand your staff with which you struck the Nile and go. No, ito ang instruction at dalhin mo ilang mga elders. Now, hindi again sinabi sa atin yung reason. Ito bang mga elders na to ay kasama dun sa ilan na nagtitiwala sa Diyos o kasama nung mga karamihan na nagrereklamo sa Diyos. But twice in that passage, makita natin nag-perform ng miracle si Moses in the presence of the elders in verses 5 and 6. Okay? But God's purpose may be to teach the elders to trust in the sufficiency of God. And to show the elders that God or Moses was not acting alone. Hindi siya nag-iisa. Kasama niya ang Diyos. And of course, perhaps, to protect Moses from being killed. And as we have seen in the past, ano pa ang isang instruction? Dalhin mo yung staff. Di ba? Remember, kasama na yon dun sa bush. Sa burning bush, di ba? Dala-dala niya yon. Pero this time, it was very specific. The staff with which you struck the Nile. Itong staff na to na ginamit mo nung hinampas mo yung tubig ng Nile na ang lumabas ay dugo at ang nangyari kamatayan, this time it will bring forth river of the water of life pag in-strike mo yung rock. In verse 6, behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it so that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. And see, we see here that God continues to demonstrate his undeserved mercy throughout the pre-Sinai wilderness experience. Uniform ang nangyari, di ba? Kapag may nangyaring hindi maganda in Israel, magdi-disobey, magre-reklamo, tapos God blesses them. Now listen, the lesson here is not, it's okay to disobey God. Hindi yun ang lesson. Okay? Hindi yun ang lesson. Ang lesson, bago sila dumating sa Sinai, makita na nila, matutunan na nila that salvation is not earned. It is not work salvation. And it is as if God is telling them, you will fail, you will falter sa bawat hakbang, no, sa inyong dinadaanan, but I am still going to bless you. Not because of your good deeds, not because of your accomplishment, but because of my covenant promise to the patriarchs. Yun ang kanyang pinapangako. And so pinabubulaanan ng Diyos, no, bago pa lang sila dumating sa Sinai, ang inyong kaligtasan ay hindi nyo paghihirapan. Hindi yan dahil sa gawa nyo. And then sinabi niya, he has promised now to stand before Moses. Right? The pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire is the Lord will stop and stand doon sa rock chosen for the miracle. Pansinin niyo po, it is a specific rock. On the rock. Definite yung article. Okay? This is the first of the 77 times this word will be used in the Old Testament and speaks specifically of the Lord. Ang Panginoong Jesus yung ang rock. The last time it was used is in Habakkuk chapter 1 verse 12. Are you not from time everlasting, Lord my God, my Holy One? We will not die. You, Lord, have appointed them to deliver judgment, and you, O rock, have destined them to punish. So the rock is Jesus Christ. And the rock is said by the Lord, nasaan? Nasa Horeb. Ang Horeb, arid, desert. Na in-expect nyo na, yung rock, nasa Horeb, nasa desert. At kung pinalo ito ni Moses, di ba, magkakaroon ng water. So, this will be a great miracle dahil yung rock nasa disyerto. And nung pinalo ni Moses, yung tubig, it's not just kakonte, pero sapat ang sinabi po doon that the people may drink. Right? Hindi lang yung mga tao, pati yung livestock. Mga baka, mga tupa na kasama nila doon ay nakainom. You see, 2 million people plus the livestock Nakainom silang lahat. The Lord our God is the God of miracles. And tanda natin, pag gumawa siya ng himala, hindi po kapipiranggot para patikimin ka lang. But it will fully satisfy you. Diba? Pag nagpagaling siya ba, yung bulag nung pinagaling niya, kalahati lang yung nakakita? Hindi. Ganon ang Diyos. And here we see the hand of Moses is used as the principal cause of the action. Yung rod, the staff, is the instrumental cause which brought this miracle. And brethren, the glory of God is the final cause. Si Moses, representative ng Panginoon. Yung rod, yung staff, ipinakita sa atin, has the ability to produce, to accomplish the miracles of God. And God is glorified to care for His people. And lastly, in verse 7, makita po natin, ano ba yung meaning? Ano ba yung gustong ipakita? Ano ba yung nature ng trial? Then he named the place Massa and Meribah because of the quarrel of the sons of Israel. And because they tested the Lord, saying, is the Lord among us or not? Now, it is rare for a place to be given two distinct names in the Bible on just one occasion. Massa and Meribah. But the Lord determined that it would be so. Ang name ng Massa, testing. Ang Meribah, quarreling. The people had quarreled with Moses and had tested God. Now, what is the testing here? Ano ibig sabihin tested? They tested God. Demanding that God will meet their demands as a condition for their allegiance. Kagaya ng pinag-usapan natin kanina. Ito ang kondisyon. Para kami ay magpatuloy sa iyo, para kami ay mag-follow sa iyo, para kami ay sumunod sa iyo, gawin mo muna itong hinihiling namin. And Moses clearly, specifically, tells us the nature of this trial. The people of God have dared to call into question the good and loving providence of God. Ang Diyos gracious. Pero nagkasala ang mga Israelita. Tinanong nila, is the Lord among us or not? That is a very dangerous question to ask. Aren't they stupid? Di ba may cloud? The pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire. Mula nang lumabas sila, nandoon sila, papunta doon na sa Red Sea. Remember that? Di po ba? Andoon yun. And then the manna. The quail, at tapos yung mara, di ba, na mapait na tubig. How can they doubt the powerful presence of God? Have you come to that point in your life because of ito, the standing issue for the life of faith, that you question the very presence of God? Now, we need to be very careful when we assure people, listen, that it's okay to be angry with God. Minsan naririnig niyo yan. No? Sa mga recovery programs. Okay lang, ilabas mo kay God yung galit mo. Because, no, you know, there are times when we are talking to friends who are going through difficult trials. Sometimes they encourage these people with the example of sino sa mga prophet nagreklamo sa Diyos? Si Hezekiah. He was able to take his deepest and most painful questions to God when he stood on the wall and he said, Lord, I don't understand this. I don't know. It's so unwise. It's so unloving. Hindi pa pwede to. Now listen, though there are times when God is so gracious to let us voice those questions, we must never presumptuously call God and say, how dare you, Lord? Mag-iingat po tayo. Because God is to be trusted because He is God. And He has already shown that He is trustworthy. So He is to be trusted no matter what. And Moses is reminding that truth to all of us. Don't you presume on God. Don't you make a demand of God and say, Lord, I will follow you if you do this. And so the point of the whole account is that the Lord is indeed present among the people. Right? He is their abundant, never-ending source of life-giving water. To truly understand this truth would put an immediate and complete end to all of our testing of the Lord. Nakakalungkot, in the end, sa story, yung mga Israelites didn't heed the warning and learn the lesson. So ang question ni Pastor, what are the simple takeaways sa 7 verses na to? Una, be realistic. Kung titingnan nyo mga Israelita, hindi ba sila somewhat melodramatic about their present crisis? Last week, pinag-aralan natin, di po ba gutom na gutom sila? They were hungry, but they weren't starving. In fact, di ba, sanabi nga natin, pwede nga nila pag nagugutom sila, kainin nila yung livestock. Kainin nila yung mga baka, yung mga tupa na dala nila. And in chapter 15, the Mara incident, and here in our passage, they were thirsty, but they were never not dying of thirst. At least not yet. Kayo po ba mga kapatid, have you ever been melodramatic about your present situation? Do you realize how much less you would complain if you spoke realistically? I am hungry, but you are not yet starving. I am going through a difficult time, Lord, but life is not that horrible yet. Lord, I'm having a bad day, but it isn't really a crisis. Lord, sana yung good old days na inahanap ko, actually, anong difference yan sa araw sa mga nangyayari sa ngayon? Halos kukunti lang. You may feel like you never win anything, but if the truth is that you have received so many things that you are undeserving. At ang totoo lang, hindi lang naman ikaw nag-struggle. Yung kino-compare mo yung life mo dun sa iba, sa tingin nyo, kasi mas parang tingin mo maganda buhay nila, masaya sila. But they have also their own struggles, right? And in fact, kung sila Christians, because they know, meron silang godly perspective sa kanilang dinadaanan. They focus on eternal matters. They focus on the things of God. They focus on the providential care of God. Nakafocus sila sa mga promises ng Diyos. Nakita nila yung value nila kay God. Nakita nila na yung anumang dinadala nila ngayon ay binigyan sila ng sapat na biyaya. Binigyan sila ng sapat na lakas ng Diyos para makayanan nila. And therefore, you are not as unique as you think. Nagsasuffer din. Merong bawat isa sa atin, merong dinadala. But we must have later on, no, a godly perspective. Okay? But number two, realize that complaining is against the Lord and not men. Diba sa verse 2, why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord? So sinasabi ni Moses, kapag tayo ay nagre-reklamo, saan daw nakatuon yun? Sa Diyos. Natatandaan nyo, they were moving as the Lord commanded. Tama po ba? And therefore, kaya sila hindi masaya, sila'y nagre-reklamo, no, tungkol sa kaparaanan ng Diyos. No, doon sa job ng Diyos. Now, di ba tayo rin, God has ordained our step mula pa noon hanggang ngayon? Hindi ba pareho lang din? Pareho lang din. Nung lumabas sila sa Exodus, di po ba, dito sila papunta, but God directed them here. Pansinin niyo po, hindi ba pareho din? If you believe that God is sovereign and He is in control of every detail of your life, and that began, no, sa simula't simula pa lang. In fact, before the foundation of the world. And kung ano man yung tinataya nyo, oras natin, mali, 1:59. It is 11:02. Lahat na nangyari sa buhay natin was ordained by God. Amen? Ibig sabihin, if it was ordained by God, si God ang nag-aayos ng lahat na yon. So pag nagreklamo kayo, hindi kayo nagre-reklamo sa asawa nyo. O so, kung sa mga tao, nagre-reklamo kayo sa Diyos. When you are unhappy about your circumstances, you're saying, God should have treated me better. When you are unhappy with what you have, you're saying God hasn't provided well enough. When you are unhappy with circumstances, with people or situations, ang reklamo nyo, God should have made them differently. How dare we complain against the one who gave us life? How ungrateful for us to complain to the one who saved us by His grace. So, imbis na tayo ay mag-complain sa hard times, we should be turning to the Lord all the more because He knows what you're going through and because He loves you so much, all the more. Di ba, ang ganda kanina nung kante? He dances over you. Pagkano ka naman, that's in Zephaniah. He sings over you. He rejoices over you. Diba? You have to turn to the Lord for the strength that you need. Lord, nilagay mo ako dito, ayoko dito. But because you have placed me here, dapat dito ako mamunga. Then bigyan mo ako ng sapat na kalakasan, na biyaya upang sa ganoon makayanan ko ang dinadaanan kong ito. We should be better served, brethren, to learn the lesson rather than spurn the teacher. And third, kagaya na sinabi ko nila, develop a godly perspective. What I mean here is to fill your heart and your mind with things that are pure and holy and good rather than dwelling on how difficult life is. What a burden that you are bearing. Hindi yun. Do you realize how much of our attitude is derived from choosing what we feed our mind? Do you realize how much of our attitude is derived from choosing what we feed our mind? Pwede mong paulit-ulitin yung mga pain, yung mga hurts mo, o alalahanin mo lahat ng pangako ng Diyos sa'yo. You can focus on your struggles or focus on your privileges to be called sons of God. You can see the faults of others or seek the person who needs the grace of God. You can dwell on the bad thing that would happen or the blessing that might be produced. Ano? Piliin nyo. Ano ilalagay nyo sa mind nyo kapag dumarating kayo sa mga matitinding pagsubok? Pastor, parang napakasimple niyan. But you know, please understand that when we are in one of those negative frames of mind, the thing that you least desire to do is to read and study the Word of God, is to pray, is to sing, is to worship Him, is to serve Him, is to fellowship Him. Diba? Kapag negative ang laman ng utak nyo, sumasama ba kayo sa game of the generals tuloy? Sa growth group? Replay. Sumasama ba kayo sa mga fellowship, sa men's, sa women's, sa prayer meetings? Nagsiserve ba kayo kapag kayo ay magulo ang isip? Nagwo-worship ba kayo? O external lang, kagaya ng pinag-usapan natin kanina. Ayaw ng Diyos yun. Ang gusto ng Diyos, makita niya sa puso ng bawat isa sa atin, tunay na nagtitiwala sa Kanya. In fact, kapag magulo yung isip nyo, you don't even want to hang around happy people. So in these times, kapag tayo po ay naguguluhan, no, tinatamad, drag yourself to the Word of God. Force feed. Remember I told you before? Force feed yourself. Kapag dumating kayo sa point na tila baga nagtatampo na kayo sa Diyos, andun na kayo gustong tumalikod, pilitin nyo ang sarili nyo na magbasa. Because when you seek Him, you pursue His righteousness, ibibigay niya. Alam niya ang puso ng bawat isa sa atin. And then you will see the perspective that you need. You will find the perspective that you need. Because God will give you wisdom and the Spirit will empower you and help you and guide you and counsel you. And lastly, hang around positive people and consciously pay attention. Alam po na bawat isa sa atin how uplifting positive people are. And so we need to consciously pay more attention to them. Hindi po ba napakasarap to be with positive people? They make you smile. They make your day better. They turn your bad day into a good one. Find those people. Study those people. And try to be one of those people. Remind yourself that you'll be a greater influence for Christ as a cheerleader rather than a complainer. Di po ba araw-araw napapalibutan tayo ng mga taong discouraged, beaten down by life? Sino dito gustong kasama mga complainer, mga grumbler? Wala. What people need is someone, brethren, with a godly and holy perspective. And I hope that GCFNE, bawat isa sa atin, will be able to reach out to people because they see in us that godly perspective. We cannot impact the world for Christ if we repel people with our personality. We live in a world of hurting people. People who are simply living from day to day. They see little purpose in life. Ang kanilang goal to gain as much as they can before they die. And they need you and me to infect them with the good news of Jesus Christ. They need you and me to live with joy, not just talk about it. They need you and me to point to the future day of glory that makes our struggles in the present less burdensome. Amen? Nawa ang bawat isa po sa atin ay ma-equip upang sa ganoon tayo po ay makatulong sa mga taong nakapalibot sa atin na nasasaktan, na nadidepress, na mga taong nanghihina dahil sa dinadaanan nila sa buhay. Kailangan makita nila sa bawat isa sa atin na tunay nga na ang Diyos ang siyang nagko-control ng ating buhay. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let us find our rest, salvation, hope, and comfort in you. Guard us, O Lord, from ourselves, that we may not test you. We may not be hardened, and we may not turn from the rock who alone can quench the thirst in our sin-sick, weary souls. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Praise God for that wonderful and inspiring message na reminded not to magreklamo sa Diyos. Before we proceed with the giving, no, I'd like to read 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, very familiar. No? Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Meron akong tanong, no? When we think of worship, no, ano yung normally na ginagawa natin every Sunday morning? Pumapasok sa isip nyo pag nag-worship tayo. Siguro yung pagkanta, yung pag pagkakinig ng salita ng Diyos. But always remember that there are part of the worship, two of the most important elements of worship are in our prayers and in our giving. Giving the first of what we have to our Creator is a tangible way of expressing our trust in Him. Kagaya ng message kanina, no? To meet all our needs. When we give back to God, we are expressing our trust in Him and in His provision. When we pray over our offerings to God, we are asking Him to bless that which we give and use it for His purposes. Okay, as we give, let's be reminded that God is the owner and everything that we have comes from Him. Let us pray, Lord, You are the giver of all good things, and Your word makes clear that every good and perfect gift comes from You. Lord, please accept our gifts and offering to You for Your glory. Thank You, Lord God, for blessing our working hands, our minds, and our businesses. And we pray, Lord God, that our offerings to You and accomplish with them more than we could ask or imagine. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God for that successful leaders retreat. Thank you for your prayers. It was really a great time of bonding and also of assessing, evaluating the different ministries of the church. Ang aming guest speaker ay si Kuya Tom Rojas, the former president of IGSL, and his wife, Ate Cynthia. And please continue to pray for the leaders, especially the plans that we have for the next 6 months. Sana po ay magawa at makatulong ang bawat isa sa atin for the glory of God. And for announcement, we would like to congratulate also Pastor Marvin for graduating, no, ecclesiastical degree in pastoral ministry. Pastor Marbs, praise God. And meron pa po bang nag-graduate ng college? No, purihin po ang Diyos. And please continue to support our covenant giving. Meron pa rin po tayong mga forms dyan. And continue to pray, no, para dito as we raise fund to pay no, fully ito pong space na to by 2025. So tayo po ngayon ay prayer huddle time. So may I request everyone to please rise, look for a partner for our one-on-one prayer. So we have time. I'll give you 5 minutes. I give you 5 minutes to pray for someone. Please look for a partner. Two more minutes. One more minute. May I request everyone to please rise as we close in prayer. Tayo po ay manalangin. Our loving Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, our Savior and Lord, and your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory indeed is higher than the heavens. May your glorious name be praised. May it be exalted above all blessing and praise. Marami pong salamat muli sa isang araw ng pananambahan na ito. Nawa ang bawat isa ay nakatagpo ka, nakaugnay ka, Panginoon, mula ng pagpasok nila dito sa sanctuary at sila, habang sila'y umaawit kanina at habang nakikinig ng iyong salita. Nawa ang bawat isa, Panginoon, lalabas dito na tunay, Lord, na naranasan kanila. May you continue to reveal yourself to them, Lord, sa amin pong prayer huddle, nawa ang kanilang mga dalangin na naidulog sa iyo ay magkaroon, Panginoon, ng kasagutan. Lord, and I pray because you are an omnipotent God. Wala pong makakapigil ninuman, kahit sino man, Lord, sa mga plano mo sa amin. Nawa, Lord, maging sensitive kami sa kalooban mo. Maraming salamat. And we pray, Lord, for those who are celebrating their birthdays and couples celebrating their anniversaries today. At sa mga darating na araw, we pray, Lord, for your blessing on them. Thank you for your sustaining grace. And thank you for how, Lord, you are going to bless them for this new year nila. And we pray also for those who will travel. We pray, Lord, for safety. And we pray, O God, for those who will make decisions this week, big decisions, be there for them, guide them, counsel them. Thank you so much, Lord. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Let's clap our hands and let's sing Only a God Like You.
Only a God like you, only a God like you, only a God like you.
Let's sing it again, only a God.
Only a God like you, only a God like you, only a God like you.
Only a God.
Only a God like you, only a God like you, only a God like you. World, I'll never give my heart away, a shout.